Library Matters public forum to talk about the redevelopment of the main branch that we're hosted here tonight in. My name is Carrie Lynn Poole Cottenham. I am the treasurer of QP Local 503, who represents 600 members who work in the Ottawa Public Library, including this branch and 32 others in our wonderful community. I'm glad that so many people came out. We didn't know what to expect. And I think it's a really important evening where we have some wonderful panelists who are going to be speaking tonight about the issues when it comes to the redevelopment. If you didn't check in, there is a table just outside the doors where we do have some fact sheets about the redevelopment of the branch, as well as a sign-up sheet. We officially have launched our Library Matters campaign, and we have a website, so it's ourlibrarymatters.ca. We're on Twitter, Our Library Matters, and we're also on Facebook. So, of course, this is just the start of the campaign. We know that things are starting to move at a bit of a quicker pace. I do also want to call attention to one of our coalition partners. You may or may not have heard them, but Bookmark the Core is another group. Great. Nice to see them in attendance, who are also doing some mobilization work in the community about the very issues that we're going to be talking about, in particular the location. So it's truly a testament of how important the services are that are offered in the Ottawa Public Library, and we're very excited to be here today. So in addition to launching the website as well as the Twitter and Facebook and different ways to engage, we also have produced a short video that kind of profiles a bit of the work and how libraries contribute to vibrant communities. And we're going to be pleased to show that to you now.
What's a library? Well, the dictionary definition is a building where books, periodicals, and other materials, such as videos and musical recordings, are available for people to use or borrow. But that description hardly does a modern library justice, does it? Because today, libraries are more than just stuffy, silent book depositories. Today, libraries are vibrant cultural and social hubs, often architectural showplaces, where men, women, and children of every age, social strata, race, creed, and color gather to discover, to discuss, to dream. Today's libraries are multimedia gateways to all the world's knowledge, portals to the arts, literature, and music. They provide vast electronic resources and a dizzying array of programs and services that play an important role in the fabric of our ever-evolving society. Libraries also level the playing field, especially when it comes to literacy and computer skills training, ensuring that knowledge and technology are available to everyone, not just to those who can afford it. We are truly fortunate in the nation's capital. We have a wonderful library system dating back over 100 years, with 33 branches spread throughout urban and rural Ottawa. At its heart is our main branch, a dynamic municipal resource that not only strengthens our downtown core and champions our cultural lives, but does so in a safe and welcoming environment. Office workers pop in at lunch to use the genealogical services. Students drop by after class to do their homework. Seniors stop by for a seminar on personal finance. Children and parents assemble for family story time. Our main branch is a civic treasure, a place that empowers, that enlightens. It embodies the art of possibilities for young and old. It belongs to every citizen in Ottawa. It should not belong to a private company so that they can commercialize and profit from it. It's worth funding. It's worth fighting for. Keep it downtown. Keep it public.
Isn't that great? So we would encourage everyone to share the video, use social media. It is available on the ourlibrarymatters.ca website. And we're really hoping that it does get some traction, and that only happens when people engage and help us along. So I just want to go over a bit of the format for this evening. So if you're French speaking or if you'd like French translation devices, they were out at the table when you checked in. We do have simultaneous translation happening. So this would be a bit more of an accessible event for that. And our panelists do have translation devices as well. So that's what we're offering. And we're also web streaming. So if you have a friend that you want to send a text message to or you want to post it on your Facebook page. So it's live web streamed on our librarymatters.ca website. So what's going to happen is I'm going to introduce our moderator, and we actually have three panelists that Corey is going to introduce. And then they're going to give some presentations to provide some content and increase the discussion level. And then we're actually going to move to questions and answers. So that will be your opportunity after the three panelists have presented to actually ask some questions and get some content. And then as soon as that's over, we do have a hard deadline of kind of wrapping up for 8:30 because the library closes at 9. Then we're going to talk about what next steps you could take as, you know, citizens or advocates or people who live in this community who want to engage and increase some political pressure to make sure that the library and the redevelopment of the library meet your needs. So it's my pleasure to introduce our moderator for this evening. He's the former CBC Municipal Reporter from Corey O'Kelly. And he's going to be introducing our panelists and maneuvering and bobbing and weaving when it comes to the questions and answer session that will come afterwards. So thanks so much for coming, and I hope that you enjoy the evening.
Well, thank you very much, Carrie Lynn. You know, I've covered an awful lot of library board meetings, library meetings over the years. It's kind of a treat not to have to run out of here at 9 o'clock with a clip for the 11 o'clock news. So I'm going to enjoy this. When I was 9, I was living in another city, and we had to do an essay, grade 4 or 5, whatever it was, on how animals had helped mankind over the years. And donkeys, horses, camels, oxen, that sort of thing. So I joined the library, not knowing very much about it. I got a book called The Beasts of Burden. I took it home. I did my essay based on, got a B, I think. And thereafter, I put the book up in the back of my closet. I don't know how many months, was it a year later, I got a nasty note from the library asking for their book back. And giving me a whopping fine in the process. Now, my mother, who was the sole breadwinner, didn't take too kindly to that, so she introduced me to the world of high finance. And for the next month, I went out at night, collected dew worms, and sold them to fishermen. And a month later, I paid off my debt to society and returned the book, The Beasts of Burden. And it's still part of my family's lexicon today. The matter is known as the Ox Book Incident. So I mention that just because I have a great fondness for libraries. They taught a 9-year-old about independence, about responsibility, and just how important it is to have a library. I carry that today, so it's kind of nice to be asked to do this tonight. And libraries must be built properly, they must be financed properly, and they must be operated properly because they belong to all of us. And hopefully our distinguished panel will get us a little closer to that resolution. We have three of them here tonight. Louis Auerbach, on my immediate left, has interests in governments, accountability, performance auditing, the future of democracy in Canada, and organizational design. Currently, he is the head of Auerbach Consulting Services. From 1988 to 2002, he was a director audit operations for the Auditor General of Canada and the Commissioner of Environment and Sustainable Development. Previous to his work in the Office of the Auditor General, Mr. Auerbach was a senior research and policy advisor with the Treasury Board Secretariat, the CRTC, and the Science Council of Canada. He has also worked as a private consultant for Woods Gordon and as a radio and TV producer for CBC. And TV Ontario. Mr. Auerbach has an AB magna cum laude from Harvard College, an MA from Harvard GSAS in the history of science, and an MBA from Yale. It doesn't say if he graduated high school, but I suspect he did. Louis, would you come up and talk? Thank you very much.
Oh. Well, I'm not sure. Google, there was something must have been left out of them. If you search me on Google. Anyway, what brings me here tonight, apart from my love of books and libraries, stems from my time at the Auditor General, where I did lead a number of projects that looked at organizational performance with respect to cost and effectiveness and accountability. And I even was the lead director on the first audit of the administration of the Senate. And so I have experience with recommendations not being followed. When I left the Auditor General and started consulting, some of my work was for unions who were concerned about public-private partnerships and the proposals to do them in the hospital and transportation area. And I made clear to them that I didn't have any ideological opposition to partnerships between the public and private sector. But it did turn out that every one of the projects that I was asked to examine had serious cost and accountability issues. They were likely to cost more and have less transparency than the normal model of tendering to the private sector for construction and design and then public operation after that. So it was with some sense of validation that when, let me see now, I go to the next one. Do I go like that? There we go. So as you can see, I'm going to talk about the Ontario Auditor General's report. I'm going to talk a bit about the site criteria, and I'm going to make some comparisons to Halifax and Calgary. So it was with some satisfaction that when ultimately audits were performed later on several of the projects that I had examined, and most recently and comprehensively by the Ontario Auditor General, that my concerns were shown to be quite correct. P3s do cost far more, even after they're done, than do traditional methods of procurement. So I am frankly worried and puzzled that there is enthusiasm for this model of procurement at the highest levels of the city for a P3 for the new library, especially before a design or location has been chosen. When the Auditor General's report came out, the Globe and Mail's Barry McKenna summarized quite well her conclusions. Quote, the province may have overpaid to the tune of $8 billion. Did you all get that piece of paper that was distributed? Because some of that, good, okay. For 74 major infrastructure projects dating back 9 years. And some of them are still ongoing. I think the light rail here in Ottawa was part of what she's looking at. And the key reason is financing. Private sector companies can't borrow as cheaply as governments can, so that adds significantly to the cost, and especially when there are contracts that run for decades. And then there are other transaction costs. Lawyers and consultants love P3s. And in fact, there's a lot more that is spent on lawyers and consultants with P3s. But the biggest variable, and what justifies the P3, is the price tag that's put on the risk that is supposedly transferred from the public sector to the private sector. And McKenna concludes by saying, unfortunately, the government has struggled to accurately price that risk, relying on the murky and potentially inflated, and I would say not potentially, actually inflated, calculations of outside consultants. Ontario's Auditor General is suggesting that the government's so-called value assessments are little more than junk science, unquote. So she's concluded, as I have, in the project proposals that I examined, that these risk transfer estimates are highly exaggerated and skewed in favor of private sector delivery. In fact, you could ask the question whether the risks are always transferred. It's a nice, expensive insurance policy. So this is really important. I want to just elaborate a bit on her conclusions. She said, and I'm quoting now from the report, There's no empirical data supporting the key assumptions used to assign cost to specific risks. And then she said, in our discussions with external advisors, for example, consultants such as Deloitte, they confirmed that the probabilities and cost impacts are not based on any empirical data that supports the valuation of the risks, but rather on their professional judgment and experience. In other words, that's the end of the quote. They usually involve simply accepting the methodologies of the clients that hired them. So she goes on and says, what would happen is the assessments, you get a statement from the accounting firm that the assessments were prepared in accordance with Infrastructure's Ontario's methodology. But all the letters saying that, you know, it was all okay contain a disclaimer by the firm, and I'm still quoting from the Auditor General here, that it has not audited or attempted to independently verify the accuracy or completeness of the information used in the calculation of the VFM, unquote. In other words, the assessments carefully followed a flawed methodology, and the resultant answer that it's less expensive to have a P3 is certifiably consistent with this flawed methodology. So, but there is one claim about P3s, and it's often true, that they come in on time and on budget. However, this is because the estimates of the costs are already higher than necessary. In fact, the Auditor General report notes that the estimated costs for projects were on average 27% higher than the actual contracted cost. So clearly, it's easy to deliver something on or below budget if your client has already exaggerated the budgeted cost by an average of 27%. So I'd be wary of any study that used the concept of risk transfer to assert that a public-private partnership would be less expensive. The risks are probably exaggerated, and the transfer may not even take place. Does this still? Ah, I got it pointed. Okay. So, in terms of the studies done for the resolution currently in front of the library board, CUPE researchers have already pointed out that the benefits and costs of a fully public or public-to-public option were not examined. And City Council's resolution inexplicably sets the public comparator as the current public library site. Why? I mean, it should have mandated that a public comparator be established for the preferred option and site. And I also question some of the criteria used for the site analysis. Full disclosure, I happen to like a variation of the 110 Laurier possibility. So I was disappointed, but I found it quite instructive to see how the criteria and the scoring discriminated against the possibility. For example, one criterion is, quote, the site does or will be able to accommodate additional mixed-use development on the site, providing opportunity for a partner to purchase excess development rights without compromising the image of the library, unquote. And they scored points according to whether the sites had this characteristic or not. Why? Is there any evidence that this partnering will enhance the site or even save money? So let's not confuse building a library with selling off city property to developers. If the city wants to sell some of its property in this way, that's a separate issue. Then there's the criterion that the site be visible from as many approaches as possible. But they put the library behind City Hall, not where the ice rink is, but on the other side. So has difficult access points, presents minimal visibility, got low points on that score. But they could have put the library in front and put the ice rink in back, but they didn't do that. And there's no explanation for why. Then there's the criterion that it be within 400 meters, I don't know how they chose this, of a LRT station. And that cost them about 19 points in the assessment. Again, I submit that this location is still central enough, especially if it's used in that larger space in front. So a different, what I would think a more appropriate set of criteria, location, would score it higher than all the other sites, with the possible exception of 557 Wellington. Anyway, whether one or not one likes the 110 Laurier site, it's just to make my point that the criteria and scoring used by the consultants should not be accepted at face value, but should in several ways, and I think this meeting is an opportunity to start that process, be challenged, since they may bring us to solutions that are more expensive and in other ways suboptimal at the same time. So what I'd like to do for the rest of my comments is just make a few observations about the most recent and most impressive central library projects in Canada, the one just completed in Halifax and the one that's now underway in Calgary. Neither of them is a public-private partnership. Instead, both started with a location and then held a downtown location, I might add, and then held competitions to select a design that would be both a practical and community hub. That's the right way to go, I think. That's what Halifax is going to look like, or looks like, actually. It's now open. They started with an RFP, request for proposals, for an architectural consultant. And after the architect was selected, it was a Danish architect and had a local partner, the design was approved. The city went to a, what is going on there? Okay, well, anyway. And the design was approved. The city went to a consultation, construction RFP, which was awarded to Ellis Don, a company that's well known. Halifax is going to look quite interesting. And Calgary is going to look quite interesting. The city used its Calgary Municipal Land Corporation. It started with a two-step process to choose a lead design consultant. They got 38 submissions, which were, they have more than that, but they shortlisted 38 submissions. And a partnership between a Calgary architectural firm called Dialogue and a Norwegian one called Snøhetta was chosen to lead design and project management on the chosen site downtown. And I can't resist the observation that although there's no carbon tax in Alberta yet, like they have in Norway, and they don't have a $1 trillion fund from oil like they have in Norway, they'll at least have a Norwegian architect for their library. And after that, the additional project managers and construction firm were chosen to round out the team. And in both these places, about 1% of the budget went for public art. I just would like to note that, because I don't see any evidence of that in the documents I've read so far. And there will, of course, be related private developments near these libraries, cafes, and whatnot inside. But these are projects on municipal land with the municipalities in charge of the project and maintenance. So I just want to say a few words about the relative cost, since these indicate what communities elsewhere are willing to spend for a good new central library. So adjusting for population differences and building costs, population and building costs are higher in Calgary and lower in Halifax, translates to the $245 million that they're spending in Calgary translates to about $162 million for something equivalent in Ottawa for our population and our building costs. And Halifax's expenditure of $57 million would require, because our population is so much larger, $137.8 million. And these are costs that are not increased because of the cost of higher financing and the other costs of a public-private partnership. But, there's an important but here. In Ottawa, we are going to have a library of 132,000 square feet compared to what they have in Halifax, which is 129,000, almost the same size for a city that's about 40% the size of ours, and Calgary, which is maybe 20% bigger, but as you can see, is quite a bit, has a much larger library. So anyway, just thought I'd point that out. Says something about what we're doing here. So assuming we stay with our small size, and assuming we construct the way Halifax does rather than the way Calgary does, then we should expect our library to cost maybe about $62 million, or quite a lot more if we take the Calgary construction costs. It's a big, obviously, range. I just observed a couple of days ago that we did at one point have a plan for something that was a larger project. In 2009, the library board approved a plan. There was no public-private partnership. It was over 200,000 square feet, and it was planned to cost $180 million. But they hoped to raise $18 to $20 million selling the existing library space, but the plan was never realized. As Barry said to me, that the political will was lacking despite the approval by the library board. So just to sum up, my concern is that in projects of this type, risk premiums and cost efficiencies are systemically exaggerated so as to exceed the far more real additional financing and transaction costs of a P3. The fact that neither Calgary nor Halifax has gone this route, and that there is no example yet of a library P3 anywhere in Canada, should be sufficient to say that it is safer to go a more traditional route, which is likely to achieve the design and location objectives that most in our community would prefer. My fear is that the compromises that would be necessary to meet the needs and desires of a private sector partner, as opposed to a contractor who would do what the city wanted it to do, would also tend to compromise achieving the objectives that we hold for a new central library, and would as well cost more. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. You've just heard the voice of Louis Auerbach, one of the most distinguished voices in the city, raising troubling concerns about this proposal. Our next speaker, Barry Podolsky, is an Ottawa-based architect from Barry Podolsky Associates, an Ottawa-based architectural, urban design, and heritage consulting practice founded in 1969. Now, Barry was doing green before most people even thought about it, so he's revered for that here in this city. The firm has won over 28 national, provincial, and civic design awards, of which 22 have been for heritage conservation. Great pleasure, Barry Podolsky.
Thank you, Corey. I must say I'm really pleased to be here. I think that it was flattering to be invited to talk about or to share some of my thoughts about the future Central Public Library. I want to also compliment CUPE for organizing this community forum. A lot of community meetings are often initiated by, say, the City of Ottawa or the National Capital Commission when there are projects which are planned. And I know that the City and Library Board will be doing this, but it's great to see other players in civil society taking an interest in public dialogue or creating a forum for public dialogue that is complementary to what the official consultation process is about. So I really congratulate you on that and keep doing it. I think this is really, really good. I would just like to share with you a little bit of my interests. I'm obviously a practicing architect and heritage consultant, but an urban designer, but I'm very interested in the history and evolution and future of cities, particularly Canadian cities. And I think that, so I'm an urbanist, as many of us are, that have been born in cities and will live our lives in cities. We've become an urbanized country. I think something like 70% of us now are, or more, are living in cities. So this is our habitat. This is our nest. And I think that it's really important for us all to participate in transforming our cities into places that are fostering the best of human behavior and the best of our urban experiences. The specific experience that I have had as an architect is that I was lucky enough to be able to design four branch libraries in this region. The Nepean Central Library, which is, you know where that is, the Rockcliffe Public Library, and then the Cumberland and Gloucester branch libraries in the East End. And in having had the chance to design those libraries, my sort of love for places that are inspiring, that foster education, and working on how to make these places really happen in a pragmatic way was reinforced. And I was educated so much by the library consultants and the library staff that were our clients on those projects. And, you know, those experiences, as well as the experience of building other public buildings like schools, and just in the last few years, my partners and I had the opportunity to be the architects and for the renewed Canadian Museum of Nature, the Victoria Museum. That took 7 years of my life. And so I have a love not only for architecture, but the way in which public buildings are used by the public. So having said that, I don't think there's anyone in this room, or probably many in this city, that would dismiss the idea that we need a public library system, and now we wouldn't dismiss the idea of the need for a central public library. The case has been made, and I'm one of those that is a convert to that. One of the things that we have had now is a report to the library board, which goes to it tomorrow, with recommendations that talk about how it should be procured, the different options for procurement. Is it all public, or is it public-private? What kind of hybrid might we explore? And also, there have been a number of possible public sites that have been identified, with a preferred one on Wellington Street near the Breton Flats. Now, like Lou Auerbach, I don't think that review of the sites was done adequately enough. I think that if I was asked to set the criteria out, I think one of the criteria that really needs to be respected is that the library has to be a very, very public and central expression of what our cities should be like. And yes, it should be on the LRT system. We're investing $2.1 billion into that. So walking up to 400 or 500 meters from it is a very good criterion. By the way, Lou, the 400 meters is about, you know, 5 minutes walk, which is why they set that out, which I think is a wise thing to think about. The points that I wanted to make about location are that the ones that are on the table right now, and the one that they seem to have settled on in terms of recommending to the library board, probably need to be reviewed once again. And I think that the voices of the public, like the people in this room and others that have become quite interested in the future of the public library, ought to be heard. And I think that we ought not to rush into a quick decision on the next phase without looking at some other public sites, or to reviewing the ones that have been identified. Lou has made a very good case for that. I think that on the question of how you procure, how you finance, how you design a public library or a public building, And whether or not it has a mix of uses and a private development and public development, I'm not as orthodox or ideological about that, and I'll tell you why. About 3.5 years ago, our firm, along with KPMG architects, were appointed by the city to be the design architects for the new Ottawa Art Gallery. The city made the decision after 25 years that we were finally going to get a new public art gallery, and there was a political will there. And they looked at a number of sites for the art gallery. The art gallery had its own ideas, but they settled on the site adjacent to Arts Court, which has 21 arts groups in there, and that's where the Ottawa Art Gallery is today. They developed a program, like a program for the gallery, and the city settled on the site. But what they also did was they said that we think that the site is so central and so important that it should have more on it than just the art gallery. And so they went about to invite University of Ottawa to see if the university would participate. And the university said, well, look, this looks like a good opportunity. We have a need for a black box teaching theater. And we can't really get our act together to get it on the campus. And so this looks like an opportunity to move ahead with that and have it interact with the new gallery. And so the university came aboard. But there's also a lot of development potential on that site. The gallery would only take about 3 or 4 stories or less. And so the city was seeking to get intensification within walking distance of the LRT station. You have Rideau Centre expanding there. You've got the Byward Market. And so they had us design a mixed-use project, which had the capability for a 20-story tower on the site above the art gallery. And a package was put together with very specific designs for the gallery, some flexibility on the tower. We took the process through the city's planning approval process, rezoning, heritage approval, site plan control approval, the design committee approval. And then this whole package was put out for a request for proposals, a two-phase process, to the private sector. And the objective here was to have them design build the art gallery and University of Ottawa Theatre, but also to design, build, and invest in the tower. And the idea was that the city had a budget for the gallery, and they were hoping to get part of the cost supplemented by selling the developer the air rights over the gallery, and also reduce the risk, or transfer the risk for the construction to the private sector. And it was very complicated, and the process took a number of years. There was a two-stage competition among the developers. The developer that won was EBC Constructors from Montreal and Germain Hotels from Quebec City. Quebec were very interested in a new hotel. And then a company, Dev McGill from Montreal, wanted to do some condos on top. And in the proposals that all those teams made, they all were committed to and had no wiggle room to alter the design of the art gallery and the theater. They were committed to do that, and they were evaluated on that criterion. How closely do you stay, how orthodox do you stay to the original design? And so that was the process. The good news is that it was successful. An agreement was made between the city and the university and the private sector developer builder. And I just learned to my pleasure that on July the 15th, next month, the sod will be turned for the new art gallery and the mixed-use development. And I think that it's a model that we shouldn't reject. I think that the benefit of having the private sector, let's call it the P3 part of it, was not so much what they contributed for the air rights, but it was that they added to the texture of the city by adding a hotel and density where the city wanted to happen near an LRT station. So there's no easy, it should be, you know, black or white. There are a lot of areas where you can develop color. And the test of that project will be when it's built, what you will see is that the art gallery meets all the requirements that the Ottawa Art Gallery wanted. It is an iconic building, I'm just being modest about it here. But I think that there are successes in these hybrids. It takes an awful lot of work. It takes an awful lot of scrutiny and auditing of the process. And the public involvement in this and the stakeholders was critical. And I expect it to be a success. So I would be happy to answer questions about that in the next part. But I just want to share with you that interesting case study that's just ongoing right here in our own backyard. And to be fair to the city itself, they have learned from that model, and I think they're trying to apply that to the library project. I have to say, as Lou said, that there are, I think, flaws in the process that don't necessarily guarantee that this will be, you know, the greatest library on the planet. But I think that with the auditing and the monitoring and the participation of people like you and the rest of the public, let's make it that way. Thank you.
Thank you, Barry Podolsky. Interesting point about hybridizing library sites. That's going to be food for thought for some people, I'm sure. Katrina Miller joined the public interest team in 2011. Prior to public interest, she worked in the environmental nonprofit sector, where she developed and advocated for local environmental policies and programs by engaging stakeholders from the NGO sector, relevant communities and neighborhoods, and local government. She has in-depth experience managing multi-sector collaborations, developing grassroots campaigns, guiding policy initiatives through government decision-making processes, and crafting media and communications policy. I was just speaking to Katrina earlier this evening. She's lives in Toronto now, but she's a native of Chicago, and if any of you have been or seen how Chicago has developed itself in relationship to the waterfront, it's an amazing process. The waterfront is wide open, and I think you could say they put people before development. My pleasure and your pleasure to meet Katrina Miller.
Well, thanks so much for having me. I am not from Ottawa, obviously, and so I cage everything I say in understanding that I speak about a community that is your community. And I hope that the things that I have to share are things that are valuable to you in being able to put what's most important for your community first. Now, I'm going to start with giving a little bit of background that I cut my teeth on public policy and environmental activism, which really is a David and Goliath situation a lot of the time. And so I had to learn very quickly some effective ways to argue against bad policy and propose good policy. And there's three things that sort of win the day for me, at least. The first is that when you're looking at a bad policy, make sure that your critique of it is simple and straightforward and picks at the most vulnerable things. And I think we've heard some of the most vulnerable things here. And I'm going to try in my presentation to, at least in my general scan of what's before you, point out some of the vulnerabilities that I see. The second is to ensure that the solution that you want is concrete and clear. And the last and most important thing is to ensure that it's about people, that you're always talking about people, because if it's about people, then people will care. And that's how we win the day, is by making sure that people care in what's happening to their communities and in their municipalities. So let's start with where this all comes from. Now, considerations of P3s and other strange alternative funding models in order to build our public assets really come from the fact that our municipalities aren't funded properly. We have seen the decrease of funding from senior levels of government over the last 25 years, while all of our social service costs, our infrastructure costs, even our policing costs have gone up. So municipalities really are in a bit of a chokehold around their funding, but that's not just at the feet of those other levels of government. Municipalities themselves, and I think including Ottawa, have made their own constraints around being able to use the revenue tools in order to build the kind of communities we want. Tax increases, for example, have become almost a third rail politically. And because of that, we're stuck in a situation where municipalities are always saying, we don't have any money. And that's what puts us in the situation that we're in today. This is an article from CBC, I think, in July of 2014. Basically, it reports that three options for renewal of the main library branch have been presented to the library board. And the library board president reacts with this quote. He says, I can tell you that we have no money today to fund any of these three options. Immediately cancels out any ability for public funding of those three options, and ergo leads to the idea of a public-private partnership. Now, we're going to put aside for a second the assumption that a public-private partnership will actually cost less than a public option, and just see how this choice gets sort of narrowed right off the bat on the idea that the municipality doesn't have money to be able to renew its public library. We see what happens when they go down a public-private partnership path, that the choices become more and more narrow, and the community need and the community served by a public library becomes less and less central. So here we have the four criteria, the four considerations they use in order to widen the search space outside the downtown core. Two of the considerations are based on it being a public-private partnership. The fact that the OPL board itself said we want that potential of a public-private partnership considered. And the second being, as you've heard mentioned, this idea that you have to have a site that includes this extra capacity for development so that you can entice a private developer into this partnership with you. And then the other two considerations, the development of the rail line, being able to expand that kind of access to space, as well as some development of, I think it's the West Precinct that's happening now and they consider will happen in the future, is used as sort of rationale why we can expand the search area. But what they've done is basically change significantly the catchment and the location of where your public library would be. And the reason why that's so important is when it comes to public services, location is absolutely everything. In fact, someone told me today, which is a very, very handy little fact that they've given me, that in 2012, a study was done for the public library about what kind of services people wanted and how they wanted that service provided. And the most important thing that people mentioned in the study was that location was the most important thing that they thought of when they thought of how they accessed that service. And somehow, in all of this consideration, that public consideration, that community consideration about what location means to a community and how they access a public service like a library seems to have fallen off of the central point. Now, the reason why it's so important, the reason why community needs to dictate this process is because essential services, critical services, critical universally provided services like libraries are a critical part of our communities. They don't just increase our well-being, they actually make our communities more fair. And that's essential in a time when we're seeing our communities grow in inequality right now. And with inequality comes all sorts of things. Comes greater crime, comes more health issues, comes economic downturn. And so when we have universal public services like libraries, that helps to balance the scale back towards equality and increase our overall well-being. And we know that libraries and services like libraries are vital to the communities that they're actually located in. So closing a library in one place and opening a library over there in another place is not a zero-sum game. These things do not equal out, not when it comes to a true assessment of the community need. Now, some people may say, well, that's all well and good, but can we afford it? Can we afford to put community first, and its central idea and central desire for location to come first? Can we afford it with the fiscal constraints we have? Well, the truth of it is, in the report that came out last week, there's a 15% cost differential between renovating this building to fulfill all the needs of a central public library, the main branch, and a new build done through a private public partnership. 15%, now I'm a consultant, so I know what 15% is. That's like the minimal margin of error on any contract that we do. I think it was stated before that 27% was the cost overrun on most P3s. So we can see already that idea that P3s are the answer to our fiscal woes, that argument is starting to fall apart. So I have three ideas, three steps that I think you can take in starting to critique the proposal in front of you and provide a solution that's much more focused on community needs and what the community actually wants out of this redevelopment of this main library. The first one is assess the community impact of closing and selling this property. That's a key aspect of what they're planning on doing. It's a requirement of the new build that they will close this library and they will sell this public asset. It will no longer be available to this community. It won't be available to the people who most need it. It won't be available to Ottawa overall in its long-term goals for what it wants to provide as its community public services. And I think that that's a critical vulnerability in what they're putting forward that needs to be better evaluated. The second step is pull back the curtain on what is clearly a P3 bias. You know, they chose to research the idea of a P3, but they never really researched it. What they did was assume that there were certain sites that would be better matched for development through a P3, and then rated those sites much higher in their criteria. So there's the stuff called gating criteria. And if you look at the gating criteria, there's all sorts of places, and some of the researchers who've already looked into this have pointed them out, where they have clearly marked higher percentages for those buildings that are better, or those sites that are better situated for that P3 development, irrespective of whether or not they fit community need. And then the second thing, of course, is where are the other alternatives? Where are the great ideas like the public partnerships? You know, the idea of partnering with a university, the idea of partnering with another social agency to combine your resources in order to both provide the kind of growth in the community assets and community services that Ottawa and its growing population need. They exist nowhere in this plan. So you need to pull back that curtain and start to scrutinize and criticize that P3 bias. And then step three, bring community back central into this discussion. Right now, it seems that they did an initial community assessment. They decided that they needed a library that was 130,000 square feet. And then they put that aside and went ahead and started looking for sites based on being able to find one that would be able to be a feasible site for a public-private partnership. I think this is where you can offer a solution about how community belongs back as a central aspect. Community needs are a central aspect of what decisions they make from here on out. And maybe that starts with developing your own criteria. Thank you very much. There's this lovely little three-year-old who clearly likes what I'm saying. So, start with maybe trying to find some criteria of your own about what would fulfill community need. And I just came up with some, and these are just, you know, my machinations in reading the report. But one thing I thought of that certainly comes up in some of the campaigns that I've worked on before is no loss of service to the current community who's being served by this site. That should be right up front. The second one, if there is a new location, there needs to be a real comprehensive assessment and study about who needs that service and how they're going to access that service at a location and what location best fits that community of need. That's really what should be driving this, not whether or not there's development capacity for a third party that's going to come in and partner and make this suddenly financially okay for us. And then the last one, and probably the most important one, is to ensure that there is a real public participation process, not one that just has you consulted, you know, every 6 months through a town hall or a community meeting, but a real public participation process so that you are part of the decision making. And there are lots of models for how that's done through community advisory boards, through different sorts of working groups, for other participatory processes that you can look into, but find one that works for you and make sure that they make it part of the process. So, in summary, we know that municipalities are poorly funded, and we know that that's one of the things that's one of the main drivers towards these short-term, financially focused ideas like public-private partnerships. We also know that public-private partnerships, when they're studied and assessed by the Auditor General or by some of our friends on the panel, are shown not to be fiscally sound. In fact, have more risk, more cost, and way less public transparency. So the question is who do we trust? Well, we should trust our own public agencies to fulfill our own, to fulfill the service requirements that our communities need. And we should demand that they do that, in this case, as in all cases. I think it's time for the community needs to direct the policy instead of the fiscal constraints reducing our policy. And then I'd say that there's three steps for action. Critique the sale, uncover the P3 bias, and set your own community-based solutions. And thanks so much for listening to me.
Well, thank you very much, Katrina. More food for thought. We've come to that part of the program where we'd like to have some input from you folks who've come out tonight in the form of questions. Be kind and be inquisitive. If anyone would like to direct a question to anyone on the panel, will you please step forward to the microphone here. Don't be shy. One in the back.
Hi, this is not so much a question, but a comment. It's going off of what Katrina was saying. Really, when I looked at the report that was submitted, proposal report that was on the library site, there was nothing about the users of the library. It was all about the mechanics of you know, moving and building a new library. For me, everything's the location. I come probably four times a week to the library, and I know a lot of other people come even more often than that. And if the library is moved too far from where it is now, it's going to mean that a large part of the population that use it now will be denied of use of the library. And the Wellington location, although in some ways maybe it's okay, it's actually between areas of larger population concentration. It's supporting the transit way, but it's not really supporting the population that uses the library. And even the transit model that's in the report, the transit would bring people from farther away, even Westboro and such like that, in to use the library, but would be more difficult for the people who are living in Centertown here to actually get access to it. And also, there's a huge work population that comes down, and I see them use the library. If it's going to be further out, none of them will be able to use the library. It's too far away. So there's a bunch of questions like that are really, you know, problematic in terms of how it's been done. I'm not really criticizing that much about what the library considers its needs or what the general cost might be, as long as it's not too high. But that location is really, really critical. In a way, what's been talked about so far is really saying, well, Centertown, which had the library, is no longer going to have it.
I hear what you're saying. Would anyone on the panel like to speak to that apparent loss of importance to of foot traffic? Has it you know, has it made its way to the top of the board or even the middle of the board?
Well, I'd just like to say that my organization does needs assessments for community service agencies all the time. And one of the things that we do is look at the clients or the people who are using that and where they come from and how they travel to that location to assure that you understand the path of accessibility through different sorts of transportation. That's because everyone knows location is key, and that's what's missing here. We see absolutely no study and no consideration of who's being served right now, how they're getting to this branch, and how they're going to get to another location, and how that's being factored in to the consideration of other locations. And I think that's a real issue.
Katrina, you've probably seen more reports than I have. What is the weight given to foot traffic? Can you tell people?
I don't know, actually. I don't have that off the top of my head. But I do know that, you know, there's some real concerns about the weight that they put in this report for some types of transportation while ignoring other types of transportation. For example, one of the sites has a bike path within a block of it, and they mark it as having no cycling infrastructure near it.
Corey, and I appreciate your comments and your observations on location. Yes, it's location, 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 and I think that it's also location to be imagined in the long term, like 50 years, 100 years from now, because we all hope that this library will be iconic. It will serve the communities, but also maybe within 40 years or so be a heritage building and therefore be conserved for forever, and that's an architectural angle to it. I think that the game changer in this city is the LRT system. We haven't quite grasped the implications this has for city building and the fact that an LRT makes in a linear way with its stops. It alters the patterns in which we can get access to things. Yes, this library that we're in right now, the Central Library, is the Centertown local library, as well as being the main library for the city. And yes, in terms of evaluating the locations, you need to look at the working population as well. We have, 100 or 125,000 people working within maybe 10 minutes walk of this place. Having said that, I think that the report that has been written by the consultants and the staff that will be coming to the library board tomorrow, and I agree with my fellow panelists here, is it's not exceptional. I'm trying to be generous here. And the things that are missing from it are the criteria such as you have identified, and the procurement question that Lou has raised also is missing from it. I think that one of the criteria that is missing, in my view, is speaking as an architect and an urban designer, is that the location that's chosen has to be so prominent and so visible that it creates a sense of awe and attractiveness for the whole population. That's something that they not only, even if they don't attend it, they feel good that we can build the library. And I give you a really interesting example about how iconic facilities have been chosen. We all know our National Arts Centre. And 50 years ago, when the government of Canada was trying to find a site for the National Arts Centre, they had 22 different sites that they started evaluating. They narrowed it down to 7, and the one where the National Arts Center is today was essentially chosen because it was at the center of the center of the center of the city. It happened to be owned by the city of Ottawa, not the federal government, but they chose it anyway, and then they negotiated with the city because they felt it was the best place that the National Arts Center should be. And so we're at a point in time in the process of identifying a site, choosing a process for procurement and building a central library. And I don't think we're there yet. we're not really on track yet, and I hope that in the next couple of months, or maybe 6 months, with participation from the public, that we will straighten our track towards something that we will really be proud of.
Lewis, please.
That's all. Just to add to Barry's point very briefly, I was at the consultation session that the city held about 2 months ago. Very impressive presentation by the people who are consulting the library board. But you know what was off topic? Location. I mean, I couldn't believe it.
I hear some murmurs in the audience. Would you...
I'm on the mic here. I'll be standing here. I've got someone
up at
here.
The back. Come ahead, sir.
Yep. Well, thank you for coming out and for the time and for the presentations. And they're all extremely professional. It's extremely good. And what can one fault with it other than a little sense of overwhelming with it? And I'm trying to get my head together here, and I'm just following up a little on the last speaker, because there's not, you know, any great disagreement here. There's all the we've presented here with very technical stuff, but at the end of the day, it's all about library users, and I'm concerned here. I live in the city. My name is Kevin Dooley. I'm a local author, and I've got books in here, and I use this place. But there's a different. It's what a library is all about. I didn't hear. I'm not hearing that. I don't hear him hearing it at anything. Now, what about him? All the library users, all the people who have cards here? Is there any kind of process? Maybe you can answer it. Maybe someone can answer it. Is there any process of actually going to, guess what, the library users, the people who use the effing library, who can come in, and do they have any say in this? The consumers, the people who use the library, who use it, and then, as this gentleman said here in the last time, was not only use it in the sense of buying books, but use it as a place. Now, this little location where you're sitting in here, brothers and sisters, is an actual auditorium, and there's a lot of stuff going on in this town. And what a library needs more than anything else is a focal place for community-type activities. There's an enormous amount of reading groups, writing groups, social groups. This is a very, very, very busy place, this little auditorium right here, but it's not adequate enough. It's downstairs, got no windows. It's a bit of a hole in the wall. And we have, when you're talking about all your plans, where's your plans or what's in the plans for a library being? And I'm looking at here all the usage of it. Look, and it's very impressive. You've got millions and millions and billions and billions, and there's figures here coming out the yin-yang of the number of books and the number of this and the number of that. And yet there's also a lot of activities going on here, and that needs to be expanded. The place is already crowded. Now, I was recently in the Halifax Library, and I've been in the Ottawa or the Vancouver Public Library. Now, one of the things about libraries is they're also social places. They're places promoting reading, writing groups, all sorts of things. They're also community places. Is that in the new agenda? I don't know. Is there anything other than talking about the aesthetics of buildings? Thank you, sir. Out on the other thing, I know who you are. You're a wonderful author and all things. We're talking about inside the bloody buildings. I'm talking about going on in that too. And everything here, I'm coming out with a sense of frustration, and maybe I'm echoing that. It's yes, everything is right here. Get the money, find out the grants, corner the corners. But at the bottom line, it's all about the users. I'm repeating myself, I know. Is there any way of canvassing the users, as the reusers and the library people, and also to the other users of the library people, the community groups that are out there? I personally have seen I've seen whole campaigns in this city. One was the Rideau Canal Workers campaign started here to honour the Rideau Canal workers. I've seen numerous writers. I've seen people launch their very careers and lives right on that stage there. And that's what a library is all about. It's more than enough. And then yet at the same time, the book usage down here is way down. The others and the modern internet use is up. And there's issues here going on about the use of the library, the internal use of the library. And I don't think you're talking about that. I'm trying to put that on the page. But the most important thing, I feel, getting back to the process, I think the process should involve the users. So there's my few questions in there. I'm sure you got them. I haven't put them right. And thanks for your time.
Thank you. Thank you, Kevin. Thankfully, you weren't calling for a plebiscite here, but to the...
to the panel. How do you address his concern to get the average library user front and center?
I completely agree with Kevin there about the consultation process. I don't know if the library board has actually surveyed the library users yet to get their information, to get their input. If they haven't, then they ought to. Kevin is absolutely right. I think on your second point, I think that you're talking to the converted here. I think that we all imagine the library to be more than just a place for books, a place for internet access. We look at it to be a community hub. And to the credit of the library board, I think when you read their programs and their aspirations for it, it says that. And so I want to be fair to them as well. I think that we all, I think, share your values about a library, and we all want it to work that way, and we all hope that it will work that way. I think what we're talking about now is the effective steps to actually get there.
Yeah. The thing to remember is no one here is in charge, right?
I would add to that that there does seem to have been some community assessment done, which is actually how they get to the 130,000 square foot size of the library. It's the additional space is for more program space based on community assessment, I think from the 2012 report. That's not enough. That's by far not enough as far as including the actual users of this, you know, critical community asset, the library. And that's part of what I mean by that public participation piece. That's the public I'm talking about. It's the people who use this space that need to be included in an integral way in decision making throughout this process, and it seems that it stopped. If it ever was there, it stopped, and it never was there at a proper level.
Yes, ma'am, in the front.
Hello.
Hi.
Good evening. We were actually mentioned, a group that I'm involved with called Bookmark the Core, Citizens for a New Central Library in Downtown Ottawa. So, like Mr. Overback, we, in fact, were concerned about the lack of discussion of a location on that evening, March 31st, that wonderful consultation. And so we came together with that concern. But we were also concerned about the lack of public participation or sustained engagement, we would say. And we're concerned about the issue of design. Will there be an international design competition? Because we'd love it to be an iconic building along with everything else. Tomorrow evening is a critical point, it seems, in this process. And we've all been kind of, you know, thrown into these documents with less than a week to digest them. None of us experts, but wading our way through. What would your suggestion be to us? We have an idea that we should ask for reconsideration of the motion, at least to keep the scope beyond P3. But I'm really just asking for some advice to any one of us in this room that might choose to speak tomorrow night. What should we be asking of the Ottawa Public Library Board?
Panel, step up.
Well, I would suggest two things. There are many things one could ask for. But we've been discussing location. How can you go through this process without first having a location that people want? So, you know, they're putting out, so clearly the criteria that they have employed for choosing a location need to be reassessed and a good location chosen. The second thing you've mentioned and Barry has mentioned and is obvious is, and I think the mayor agrees, I've heard him say this, we do want an iconic building, something that really attracts people. So we, in order to get both those things, we have to get that started, and then we can begin to talk about the financing. And the third thing that you've referred to, Katrina, is the concept that they're talking about adequate enough to supply the services that people are going to want? And they say so. Maybe it's, you know, maybe it's enough, maybe it's not. I don't know. Those are three things, but clearly they have to, at some level, rethink some of the things that they've done. Not all of them, but some of them. I do know they want an iconic design, but the question is, where would it be? You know, is it going to be out in Bayview, you know, yards, or is it going to be in a place that really makes it a community hub?
Just a quick piece of gratuitous advice about what you might say tomorrow at the meeting. On the issue of consultation, this report, you know, just became public. It went online just a week ago. Some may have been tracking the library procurement and location process before, but I think it's a big report, and I think the public needs more time to digest it and to really bring other criteria to the table and have them presented. And in order to do that, you have to have some more time to do it. So one of the things I would certainly ask for is for them to defer adopting the report and setting a new date and holding a series of consultations with the public so that they can get more input from the users of the library itself, from the stakeholders that we're all stakeholders in the city, and I think that would help the library board make a better quality decision about the process. So that would be my advice to you.
Does that resonate for you?
Absolutely.
All right.
And by the way, please check us out. We are on Twitter as well as our...
Name your group again, please.
Bookmark the Core.
Bookmark the Core. We have time for one more question. Thank you very much.
Sorry, this is actually more of a comment. I actually do agree that location is really good to think about, because I'm from Barrhaven and I'm a bus user, and say Ruthie Dixon's actually hard to get to by bus, because the local buses for Barrhaven only run every half hour, and there's maybe only two that go there, and then only one goes there on the weekend. So where I go to instead is not the one in Barrhaven, but Centerpoint, because it's easier access by bus, despite it not being in Barrhaven. So a pure example of why location is important, because they were probably thinking about driving people there more versus the bus users. And then downtown, though, is you can't with downtown just think about, like, aesthetics-wise where it could be, because a lot of people work downtown, and then they don't have time to go to the local library when they get home. So where do they go on the way home from work? The Central Branch. So if you take it out of the downtown core, then they're going to have a hard time getting to the library in general.
Yeah, well, that's an interesting point, because, I mean, the city is city building around transit, so I don't know if they'd have to change the bus service on weekends or times like that if you moved away from the, you know, direct downtown core. Anyone have a thought on that, Barry?
Well, the bus transit way in the spring of 2018 is going to disappear between Tunney's Pasture and Blair Road, so that the patterns of public transit are going to be dramatically altered. There will be the LRT between those 13 stations. And so I think that there is the current way with which we get to libraries, but the way in the future will be by LRT, and it will change the patterns by which we do it.
I'd just like to say on transit that transit is never about one line. Transit's about a network. It's about the buses and the LRT and all the ways that you get to something. And when you evaluate the accessibility of a location, you don't just look at the LRT. You look at the whole network and where people are coming from in every part of the city. And that sounds like if that sort of assessment was done, it would better take into consideration some of the concerns potentially that you and others may have, who may not have access to the LRT as a main transit way, but maybe using bus or other avenues, because I think the LRT goes one linear route, right? So that's the kind of considerations that need to be taken into account here.
Well, I would love to thank everyone who came out this evening, but I think it's really important to follow up on action items, and I think one of our last questions was, what can we do? So tomorrow night, there is the Ottawa Public Library board meeting, where there is going to be a debate and discussion and potentially a vote if a motion of deferral does not pass on a very narrow lens of the redevelopment of the main branch of the Ottawa Public Library. And as, you know, constituents and people who live in this city, you do have the opportunity to depute at this meeting. And depute is just a very fancy word for having your say at the meeting. So what we did was we actually printed out the form that is required in order for you to speak at the Ottawa Public Library meeting tomorrow.
Where is the meeting?
It's at City Hall.
So there will be lots of seating, so people should go. And it's a very simple form to fill out. Just the date of the meeting, the name, the subject, if you come from an organization, and your street name and postal code. And we even populated that you want to speak to item number one, which is the redevelopment of the main branch. And all you have to do is be there 5 minutes before the meeting starts and hand in this form to the secretary. And you get 5 minutes on the agenda to have your say. So let's say you're not available to go to the meeting tomorrow night because, you know, two nights out of the house, it's too busy. There is another political avenue for you to have your say, and that is with your city councilor. And even if your city councilor is not on the library board, increased political pressure on your city councilor will intensify pressure on the city councilors who are part of the Ottawa Public Library Board. There's already a buzz about the fact that, you know, community groups like Bookmark the Core and ourselves are having these events and that we're starting to poke holes in the process that they have started to go down. There's been a lot of media coverage today and expected tomorrow with respect to this decision. And we all know in the first year of a term of municipal councilors, they actually want to try to, you know, improve things and move things forward. So there is a political moment ahead of us, and just because the board meeting, you know, goes a certain direction tomorrow, it doesn't mean that we stop increasing political pressure. And I think it's really important that people talk about the issues. So talking to your friends, talking to your family, maybe they're library users, maybe they're not, but I think it's good to start that conversation. So I do want to let people know that our web streaming actually went without a hitch, which, given we're in the basement, is a bit difficult when you have Wi-Fi. So we have had a number of people join us through the web streaming. So that has been quite successful. And I want to take this opportunity just to wrap up, and I want to thank our panelists. I want to thank Katrina and Barry and Lewis and, of course, Corey for hosting this. You can continue to follow us at ourlibrarymatters.ca. We're on Twitter, Bookmark the Core as well, quite active, and it's time to really turn up the heat and make sure that we get the library that we need in our community to meet the users' needs and our community needs for all of the quality services that it provides. So thanks so much for coming, and we're going to wrap it up here. If you have any questions for the panelists one-on-one, we'll be up here on the stage for just a few minutes. So thanks so much.